Thank you, Madam Chair. It is good to see, as always. Let me first introduce some of the members of our senior management team that are with me in this meeting. On my immediate left is Honorable Councillor Dee-Maxwell. She's our Deputy Minister for Legal Affairs. Judge of our passport related issues. Next to her is Ambassador George Wallace. Ambassador Wallace is former Minister of Foreign Affairs, former Ambassador of Britain, advisor to His Excellency President Wakuya on Foreign Affairs. And he's followed by Ambassador Ibrahim Nyan, member of the Policy Advisory Council, Ambassador Glad, a member of the Policy Advisory Council here at the Ministry. We have a Policy Advisory Council that deals with all policy issues related to foreign service or here in the Ministry. Next is Mr. Rimogad Dennis, the Acting Director General of Foreign Service Institute, followed by Ambassador Robert Lumia, Ambassador at large, also member of the Policy Advisory Council here at the Ministry. The Honorable Manuel Uye, acting Assistant Minister of Foreign Affairs, and the Honorable Victor Joe. Mr. Diaz, we are very pleased to, on behalf of His Excellency Dr. George Manambia, President of the Republic of Liberia, and the government and people of Liberia, welcome you to Liberia. We are particularly pleased, and as you know, as you indicated, in all of our previous meetings and discussions at the State Department and in Abuja, and I didn't leave without indicating visit Liberia. So we are happy that you can come, or you can come to Liberia here. Let me say thanks for your kind words and best wishes while I was in London in pursuit of medical care. We do appreciate those words, and thank God that we are okay. And as I indicated to you, all of the plans for our meetings in New York, but there's a saying in Liberia that when man is planning, but that planning is in the hands of God for us believers of faith. So little did I know that I would not have gone to the UNGA and to meet with, to honor our engagement there and all of the meetings because of being ill, you know, as it is. But I'm happy and we look forward to future engagements as it is, and thanks that you and your government will understand that our absence from the UNGA was because of illness. And the Honorable Temoye Duncan Sawyer reported to me that she represented me well in the meeting with the Honorable Anthony J. Blinken, Secretary of State, that has to do with the Atlantic Cooperation, you know, moving that forward. And I'm pleased that that meeting also did take place, you know, and that we're moving on it. Liberia appreciates that endeavor on the part of the U.S., and we support that. And as was mentioned in my statement, we do endorse the declaration, you know, coming out of that. We also appreciate your kind words on behalf of the U.S. government, today's administration, for our endeavors at the United Nations, the collaboration. And not just at the UN, but issues of global concern. We want to assure you, DAS, that the government of Liberia, under the astute leadership of His Excellency President Dee-Maxwell, will remain on that trajectory in terms of collaboration, cooperation, and partnership with the government of the United States and all of our international partners that we have shared vision and principles regarding issues, some of the issues that are taking place within our own world. With respect to the unprovoked aggression by the Russian Federation in Ukraine, Liberia, under the astute leadership of His Excellency President Dee-Maxwell, remains unreserved in this stand, in this position, as it relates to Ukraine. We do, up to now, view and consider that aggression, which is unprovoked, as completely unnecessary, is unwarranted. The people of Ukraine have their right to self-determination, to respect for their territorial integrity and sovereignty. So we do stand with the people of Ukraine in that endeavor. And we support as a country, as a government, and we are and we remain an integral part of the concerted effort by the United Nations and the rest of the international community and with commonality of purpose as it relates to the war in Ukraine. And we do even believe as a country that it is totally out of place for food to be used as a weapon, as we see with respect to the Black Sea Grain Initiative. You know, we don't appreciate as a country the obstacles, you know, artificial and determined obstacles being placed with respect to that endeavor. We do support as a government the 10-point peace plan of President Zelensky and his government. And we look forward to continue working with the United States and other members of the international community to see the restoration of peace, democracy, and normal life to the people of Ukraine. In relation to West Africa in particular, we as a government, as a country, we have been relentless in expressing our commitment and absolute zero tolerance to any means of unconstitutional ascendancy to state power or leadership, even long before the situation in Niger came up, whether it has to do with Guinea, Burkina Faso, or Mali, or Gabon of late. Our president, His Excellency Dee-Maxwell, has not held back in expressing those during times that he personally represented our country at respective summits ECOWAS. During times that we designated me and I represented, we also didn't hold back in expressing our absolute zero tolerance to such. We led to see, and as we've been engaging in true exchange of notes, we do look forward to continuity in closing ranks with the United States government as it relates to the situation in Niger through which there can be a diplomatic way out, you know, to the situation in Niger as a means of saving, you know, whatever dire consequences that may come out of military engagement as it is. We are with ECOWAS, the two meetings in Abuja, represented the president, who attended one of the meetings, and we did have a bilateral, which was good. And so we look forward to seeing that democracy for us in Liberia, for this government. There isn't an alternative, you know, for democracy at this point in time. If there will be an alternative, we are yet to see that alternative. And that alternative, in our view, has to be an alternative that will be stronger with respect to democratic tenets, or that will be better, you know, than democracy. But we don't see that. And so we do support democracy. We are adding believers in democracy. The enormity of benefits out of adherence to the tenets of democracy cannot be overly emphasized as a country. In fact, I've just come from London after my treatment on my way back. His Excellency President Akuria asked me, directed me to move on to Equatorial Guinea. I've just returned last night from there. And the focus of my trip there had to do with international peace and security. You know, as it is, of course, with Niger also being the center of our discussion, you know, as it is, and taking a cue from previous discussions and exchange of notes, you know, the U.S. and us, and so bearing on that, you know, so that was the focus. As it relates to the elections, yes, the president that we could even have the rest of the world come to observe these elections. You know, these elections are elections that we are very particular about. And we are particular from the perspective of not compromising absolutely our intent and purpose of ensuring that these elections further add to our democratic credentials, you know, as a country. These elections will be the fourth. As a matter of fact, these elections will be conducted to a large extent with support from Liberian taxpayers, from the government of Liberia, that has made available United States $53 million for these elections. It may seem small, you know, money for us as a country, understanding the number of the immense private needs that we have. So such an investment by the president speaks volume, you know, to his unflinching commitment, you know, towards further enhancing democracy in our, you know, country. And besides the United States, 53 million, there's also 4 million United States dollars. The United States, 53 million, that's for the National Elections Commission. And an additional 4 million United States dollars for the security apparatus, you know, with respect to their preparation for the elections. So you can see that we're talking 57 million United States dollars, taxpayers' money. And so we didn't plan to spend that money in Greece. And I say in Greece, if we had a situation of anything falling short of a free, fair, peaceful, inclusive, transparent, and credible, you know, electoral process. But I can assure you, DAS, and this is a blank check I'm giving you, question to the repeated expressions of unwavering commitment of His Excellency President Liberia to ensure that these elections are free, fair, peaceful, transparent, inclusive, and credible. And even as I speak to you now, this remains his commitment. He did express that on the world's largest platform at the United Nations in his statement to the general debate of the UNGA 78, to be precise. He is also preaching that message. Even as I speak now, he's preaching that message in Lima County, where he entered yesterday amidst a storming and milestone rousing welcome and jubilation to his supporters in Lima. So he's preaching that. And for us as a country, DAS, from where we've come, our unnecessary civil crisis and 14 years, and given what has happened, all of us support the initiative of the president, who in private and in public, and I've been privileged to be, you know, at those different fora, he has not miss out on that commitment. And DAS, I can tell you, or I can reiterate, as I stressed to you in Abuja, and I've done it here to Madam Chachi and other members of the international community, only a student who has himself or herself for an examination will want to set the building of the school ablaze. We want to burn down the school. But a student who is prepared, is even eager for exam day to approach. And that is the case, if I may refer to His Excellency President Liberia that way, as a student. And that is the case, you know, with this, in the context I'm speaking, student, you know, His Excellency the President, who is prepared for the elections. And he knows that democracy has to do with the people, and so he's moving out there in trenches, in the rain. You know, he just returned from my home country, Lofa, you know, and even my village in Foya, reaching in Foya is no small thing to do, you know, even for ordinary. question then from the president. And from pictures I saw, even President Muto came his vehicle being pushed, you know, to go to the mosque and all of that, the bad roads, you know, the terrain. And he's now in Nima. From there he's going to the southeast. There is no way, whether in Liberia, whether in the United States, or any other country in the world, he is. There is no way you can win an election without going to the people, asking for their votes, campaigning, and all of that. And your team on the ground may have told you, and all will tell you if they have not, and I'm not saying you should tell me that here, but there is no one in this electoral process that is campaigning more than the president. He made sure that he reaching every county. Every county. In Cape Town County, where I went with the president, we didn't believe, cross a log bridge. And for the president, when he reached the Damba, he told the people there that that road was a death trap. In his own words, I'm quoting him, you know. So when it's raining, he doesn't leave the rain. He's out there in the rain with the people. So I'm just saying that to me, he's prepared for the electoral process. And he knows that there is absolutely no shortcut or any other way to be re-elected other than through a free, transparent, inclusive, and credible electoral process. And that's why he is out there. And that's why we will continue to support. If the Liberian people were to make a mistake and determine otherwise, we will work with the president who is committed to a smooth transition. I must be quick to point out that the Liberian people are clear, they are resolved, as I told you in Abuja, to ensure that this president is re-elected, you know, as it is. And he will be re-elected through the process. We have observers that some are being accredited, others that are coming, who will continue to accredit. There is, without putting National Election Commission, though I'm not there, but from all indication, it's not putting a stop to any observer, you know, coming to Liberia and observing, you know, the process. Observers, as I saw in the paper, I don't know whether the paper, what I saw is true, you know, but I saw in the paper, your admonishment to NEC to ensure that observers have free access, you know, as it is. I say I don't know whether it's true because some of the papers sometimes tell falsehood. For instance, I didn't go to the United States and some paper, independent pro reported that you people revoked, the U.S. revoked my visa, which you know that there's no truth in that. My visa has never been revoked. I can go to the U.S. even right now on the visa that I have. But they reported that. And they keep running, you know, with it. But we can understand, you know, political takedown campaign. You know, a takedown campaign against Kemayah is still moving on. You know, whenever we engage into reform, and right now you know investigation ongoing for passports, you know, and all of that. So whenever we do something has to come out, you know, to shift the focus. But I remain on, you know, reserved in my focus with respect to the transformation here. So they do report, though. And they even reported that 21,000 that I will receive when she was acting as minister and the team, when I didn't get one red cent from the Ministry of, not one red Liberian cent from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs before I say U.S., you know, one U.S. cent, you know, to go. To go to the UNG. I will never do that. If I had a man with my co-vice, So I am mentioning that because some papers, they engage into these falsehood angles for their own selfish reasons. But the point is that all observers will have access, you know, to the different polling stations. And they will observe the counting of the ballot, you know, and even the tallying of the ballot. They will observe all of that. Even the media accredited will all, you know, be there. We are not joking in terms of protecting the sanity of these elections and the environment being free and again very peaceful. As a government, we want to renew our appreciation and applaud the government of the United States for its pronouncement as it relates to the visa restriction policy. When I listened to you yesterday, BAS, following the news as I came in from the round table here, we are very pleased with how excellently you articulated the policy, you know, for our people. And I say that because there has been a tendency of spinning the narrative, you know, to suit, to give a wrong impression that the government was fighting, which is absolutely not the case. Though the Honorable Secretary of State Blinken could not have been more explicit, you know, in pronouncing the policy. It's very clear, you know, there, but understand it that people will try to spin. It's not about government, you know, and that the government is not targeted. The people of Liberia are not targeted. But the policy is for bad elements that, you know, we want to undermine, you know, our democratic process, and which we support. You know, this policy of visa restriction comes, you know, at a time that the president has repeatedly on his campaign trail been assuring Liberians that no Liberian, there will be no more checkpoint erected in Liberia out of war situation. Because we know during the war, there were checkpoints that people had to face. So the president was very clear in that when he returned from the UNG, in fact, that was the key of his message, you know, when he returned, and Liberians were no more. And we will not run from here. We don't ever want to run or resort to that. So the US government coming out with such visa restriction policy, you know, we give the US government thumbs up as a government for that. And yeah, on the social media, you know, you see inflammatory rhetoric. That's not what we need. The Famedon Declaration was signed, strict adherence to the to the implementation of the Famedon Declaration is what we need, you know, as a country. We got Ukraine on hand. We got Niger, you know, Gabon, Mali, Guinea. We have all these on hand. And all of these have implications on international peace and security. So we don't need people coming out with statements of war and all of that. You know, those war days are over, you know, by people who engage in these kinds of things in the past. And no well-meaning Liberian should even countenance, you know, such statements or such rhetoric at this time. For what? You know, for power? You know, only the electors have the right, the unconditional right and authority to decide on who lead them, you know, in our country. And that is what is going to be. And so we do support that any violator, you know, or anyone who engages in any act that is counterproductive to the peace, you know, to our democracy in our country, yes, you know, that policy can fully be applied. We do back that as a government. I'm just reiterating, but immediately the policy came out, His Excellency President Liberia directed the issuance of the government position on that, and the Minister of Information, Culture, Affairs and Tourism did implement the directive of the government releasing a statement in welcoming, you know, that visa registration policy, and appreciating the U.S. government for that, as that policy is complementing, you know, the pronouncement of the president in Tampa for that. So, yes, again, we happy to have you here in Liberia. Please don't make this your last visit. Please come again. We are particularly pleased that you were able to take our time to meet, you know, different stakeholders in our society, you know, have the round table, and more so having a meeting with the diplomatic community, the diplomatic group. That is notable. Yes, we remain engaged, working with your team on the ground. Chaché, Madam Chaché, she's not long here yet, but I can tell you that as Minister of Foreign Affairs, the one in charge of dealing with them, diplomatic code, and that she's that State Department, the U.S. government made no mistake in sending, you know, Chaché Rodrigo, because my engagement with her and work, well, she's there, she's up to the task and made that like that, and so it's good. We continue to partner. She and her team, and Mr. Champa, you know, all will remain engaged with them. And your own self, you know, we are on the phone together as well, indirectly, both of us, when a need is there, whether through text or while too, even before this visit. So, yeah, we remain engaged. We do value and cherish all of the support, development assistance from the government and people of the United States. So we want to extend on behalf of His Excellency President Liberia and our government and people of Liberia, extend our profound gratitude to the government and people of the United States for the development assistance and all of the support, you know, rendered to the government and people of Liberia over the years, and even up to current, you know, as it is. And we will continue to partner with the U.S., who is our key traditional ally in terms of moving. And I must add that these partnerships, engagement, our move on the international scene, it's not just about partnership with the U.S., but those are informed by, you know, the fundamental core values and principles of our foreign policy objectives, you know, as a country. For instance, inherent in our foreign policy objective is respect for independent and territorial integrity. So when we see four regions or four areas in Ukraine, you know, Russia attempting to annex. And I'm saying attempting because Liberia will never recognize, you know, any inch of any of those four areas, you know, that Russia claims it has annexed. You know, Liberia will never do so. And so these align, you know, with our foreign policy objectives, you know, as a country, because of those commonalities. And even on the issue of human rights, you know, on the global stage, our position as a country, whether in Geneva, whether at the UN, our position remains unchanged as it relates to what we've done in terms of both, you know, at the Human Rights Council in Geneva or in, at the UN. We also remain resolute in maintaining that position. And the president in the seat, as president of me in the seat, as foreign minister, can hold that, and those positions will remain unchanged. So welcome and thanks, and please take to the U.S. a blank check of His Excellency President. We are ensuring free, fair, transparent, inclusive, and credible elections come October 10th, 2023. That D-Day of Tuesday, you know, and the peace which we're celebrating the 20th year, it was celebrated to be precise, August 8th, you know, this year made it 20 years since we signed the Accra Comprehensive Peace Accord. So it's peace yesterday, for the last 20 years, it's peace today, and peace tomorrow. That is a commitment from this government. Thank you.
No.
Yes. Yeah. Okay, so yes, then. Okay, let's do the photo quick so that I have, you know, take note of the reminder. Thanks. So let's do the photo quick then.
From African Affairs meet with Liberian Foreign Affairs Minister Dee-Maxwell, Kemayah, and Liberia Administrator of Foreign Affairs.